The top 10 most annoying player behaviors today on Dungeoncraft. Welcome to Dungeoncraft. I'm Professor Dungeonmaster, and this channel is about running the ultimate game of D&D.
And I'm Deathbringer. Subscribe and click the bell icon so you'll be informed when this impudent fool uploads new videos.
So we have a very active Dungeoncraft Facebook group, and I pose this question. What are the most annoying player behaviors? And I got some deluge of responses. Over 400 game masters complaining about various player behaviors. So I've synthesized them into a top 10 list. Whenever you invite a new player to the game, you could just send them a link to this video. Or if you've played with the same players for years, you might just want to send them a subtle reminder. Don't worry, I got a plus one vest, I can take it, so I will take the hits for you. Now, without further ado, in no particular order, because they're all annoying, here are the top 10 annoying things that players do. 1. Not showing up at the last minute. However many hours that you spend playing, if it's 3 or 4, the Dungeon Master has spent probably 6 to 12 hours preparing that session. And when you don't show up at the last second, it's pretty much saying to the Dungeon Master, I don't really care. Except for illness, there's no good reason to cancel a session at the last second. My cousin's getting married. My girlfriend Sheila is going through a difficult time right now. My wife's giving me a hard time. None of these are good excuses. See this device? It's a cell phone, and on it, it's got a calendar, and it's got all the important dates right here, including your D&D game. My sisters know never to plan a family event in the month of August because I'm playing Gen Con. I've already planned to play games. Once games are planned, I don't break plans. Matter of fact, this is a good rule for life in general. Once you've made plans, even if a potentially better plan comes along, you're still gonna keep the original plans. As far as Sheila goes, she's having a breakdown right now during the game that you only play once a week or once a month. She's too needy, break up with her. As for your wife, you should ask yourself, what would Sean Connery do? Would Sean Connery ever say,
well, I'd like to come to your game, but my wife is giving me a really hard time.
No, I submit to you, he would not. And if you are absent at the last second, I declare that your character will be the official party door opener for that session, and no, you don't get experience points. That's official canon from now on. 2, coming late. Late equals rude. You have 168 hours in a week to get your shit together. On this device is an app called Waze. It tells you exactly when you will arrive. Leave earlier. How come my players who live in a different state, miles away, always arrive first, but the people that live around the corner always arrive last? What's up with that? Oh, something came up at the last second. What? What could come up at the last second? That should be the something you ignore. Oh, I had to feed my kids. What, you don't know that your kids need to eat every day? And I got one word for you, beefaroni. It's what gamers' kids eat on game night. Are your kids a vegetarian? Fruity Pebbles. Pour them some Pebbles, toss them a juice box, and you're good to go. 3, cell phones. Ever see a stage player in a musical? Ever see the actors checking their cell phone messages during a performance? What do you think the director would say? Can you imagine an actor saying, well, Romeo wasn't speaking, so I just thought I'd check my messages. Players, a role-playing game is a performance, and you are the star. You need to be present. Either you're there, or you're somewhere else. From henceforth, there are no cell phones at the gaming table. When the game begins, you're going to shut them off, and you're not going to pick them up again until the game is over. And no, I don't want to see a funny cat video. And no, I don't want to see a video of your cute kid losing their first tooth and they can turn it around 360. It's gross. This is a fantasy game. Here's my fantasy. For 2 or 3 hours, I want to imagine that my kids and no kids exist. Patient that of an emergency room surgeon. Because if you're not a surgeon or Batman, there's no such thing as a real emergency. Your wife is texting. She's only texting about one of three things. You need milk, eggs, or bread. Stop off and get them at the market at the way home. Your girlfriend's texting. You shouldn't even respond. Ignore her. She'll like you better. You shouldn't even told her there was a game in the first place. You should have been like, Sheila, there are things about me you don't want to know. Things you couldn't know. Things you shouldn't know. And now, I've got to go. Is she gonna be angry? Sure, for a time. Then paradoxically, she's gonna like you better. you are welcome. Your kid is texting? That's not an emergency. They want to know what's for dinner, and the answer is beefaroni, now with a convenient pop top. 4, bringing food and not sharing. What's up with players that arrive with an entire foot-long submarine sandwich and nothing to share with the rest of the table? Listen carefully, if you attend a role-playing game session and you bring food, you must bring food for everyone. And whatever the Dungeon Master drinks, you're going to get him or her that too, because that's the least you could do for all the effort they put in creating a game just for you. 5, be prepared. You don't have a character sheet, you don't have your dice, you don't know which dice to use, you don't know the rules, you don't know when it's your turn. Get it together. It's your job to fill out your character sheet and to know the rules and to know the difference between an 8-sided die and a 10-sided die and to know what you're doing when it gets to be your turn. Man, I hate that. Not just D&D, but all games. How do you not know what to do on your turn? Your turn begins as soon as it ends. You're watching the other players to see how the rest of the combat shakes out, and you're using that information to decide what you're going to do in the next round. And you're not just going to decide one thing, you're going to decide the top 3 things that you want to do in case the game master says, no, you can't attack the goblin with the bow because he's got 100% cover behind that pillar. You just move to your next thing. Especially if you're a spellcaster, you are not stopping to look up anything in a player's handbook. It's your job to know what the spells do before you cast them. 6, not accepting no the first time the game master says it. Can you play a dual class barbarian bard? No. Can you play a mysterious class that I've never heard of from a supplement that I don't have? No. Can you have the glaive from Crowley? No, no, no. It's like dating. The gentleman accepts no the first time they hear it, and they never ask again. 7, talking when the game master's talking. This is the way the game works. I, the game master, describe to you the situation. Then I pause and ask, what do you do? At that point, people tell me what they're doing in turn, and I call for dice rolls if they are needed. When I'm talking, you don't talk at all. And if I'm talking to another player to my right, you're not engaging in a side conversation, checking your phone or zoning out. You're listening to that conversation because that person is your collaborator and what we're saying together affects the entire party. And you only pick up the dice when I tell you to. You don't enter a room and say, I make a perception check and just chuck the dice. You wait until I call for one. That's why I'm the Dungeon Master. 8, cheating. The character with the amazing statistics that you rolled at home, rolling a die and then quickly palming it, saying the die bounced off a cup and you should get a re-roll, saying, I didn't know what I was rolling for, can I roll it again? All of these are cheating, and we know you're cheating. You know who cheats at fantasy games? Children. Like my daughter, who used to always palm the Queen Frostine card in Candyland. So grow up, if you're not a child, you don't cheat at games anymore. 9, douchebag moves, and these are all of them. Saying, well, that's what my character would do when you do something stupid. Chaotic stupid is not an alignment. Try making a character that's not an ass. Breaking off from the party so you can have a solo adventure. Not taking the game seriously, giving your characters goofy names like a druid named Forest Hump. Making jokes when the game master is trying to describe things or build an atmosphere or other people are trying to seriously roleplay. Wasting time shopping for like anything, pets or a better sword. Does the blacksmith have a better sword? Maybe their swords are a little better than mine? No. They're much, much worse. They're all -1 swords. Making characters that don't fit in, like everyone's playing Vikings or dwarves, but you want to be an elf, or you want to make an edgy loner who doesn't get along with the rest of the characters. I have news for you. You're not edgy. You're as edgy as John Mayer. And if you want to be a loner, play Skyrim by yourself. Rogues that steal from their own party, bean counting the treasure in every room, being super cheap and refusing to pay for anything. Like instead of paying 1 gold piece to cross the ferry, you want your character to strip off all his armor and make a swim check, even though it's February and it's freezing. Just pay the gold piece. It's not even real. And finally, 10, saying, that's not how Matt Mercer would do it. No, I'm not Matt Mercer, but you know what he and I have in common? You're not playing with either of us. Glad I got that off my chest. If you enjoyed this video, please share it with a player you love on social media. Questions, comments, or if you want to rant, put that below. Also below, you'll find links to our excellent Facebook group and Patreon. Once again, for Dungeon